our virtual greeting time. Would you take a moment, say hello, let us know that you're here today.
No. this place. Fill our hearts with your love.
Your love. Amen. Well, we do welcome you to our service today. As we continue in this virtual mode, things have spiked here in LA, and our prayer is that all of you stay safe, that you be considerate of others, as well as taking care of yourself during these difficult days. Thank you for joining us this morning. Just a couple things. This week is a Vacation Bible School, and it will all be done virtually, as we've been talking about for the last several weeks. And if you haven't picked up your packet of material for your kids or grandkids or neighbors, whomever are watching this together, they'll still be available tomorrow as you pick them up from the church office. Just an update, Susan Kilgore is home from the hospital, and she will be beginning treatments this week the continuation of her recovery. So continue to pray for Bobby, for Susan, that God would just be in the middle of all of this, bringing her body and back to normal. We just keep praying for that. Bev Nair this week was in the hospital for a few days, and Bev is now responding to treatments, and she is home as well. So thank you for your prayers. I hope you pay attention or are connected with our email, so that as prayer requests go out during the week, you get connected with them and you're able to pray for those for whom we're praying. This is our offering time, and so I invite you to just think about your offering to the Lord, you know, your offering of your lives, the way that you serve Him day by day, whether it's in your family as husband, wife, parent, child, it's at work as an employer or an employee, it's in your neighborhood with the people who are around you as you serve them. But these are our offerings that we give to the Lord, as well as our tithes that we give every week. So whether you mail it in or you're online, thank you for your faithfulness and for your response. We know that God blesses us as we respond to His goodness, as we've just sung. So let's just pray together, and then we'll continue with our offering. Lord Jesus, thank you for this day. Thank you that, as we have sung already, that your presence in our lives removes the fears that we have. It gives us a perspective of hope moving forward, that while we're waiting for you to act in the present, our confidence is that your goodness will continue to us, and things will change as your purpose and your plan is worked out in our lives. And so, Lord, give us that confidence every day that's in the promises of your word. Lord, thank you for the opportunities we have to serve. Thank you for the opportunities we have to express our love for you and your presence in our lives as it works out from us and impacts other people's lives. Lord, make us sensitive and aware of the needs of others, the concerns of others, and put us in a position where we can serve them. And by serving them, we honor you. So thank you for our time together in worship as we have been just again focusing our attention on who you are, the goodness of the Lord to us. Lord, we're so grateful. So we just commit the rest of the service to you, to work in our lives, to accomplish your purpose in us and through us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Thank you.
And that's what we do every week in worship. We turn our eyes on Jesus. And if he is at the center of our lives, then it's well with me. Everything's okay. Thank you so much for that ministry to us. This morning, we're continuing in this series of benedictions, God's blessings toward us. And this morning, we're looking at the second benediction that we find in the book of Romans in chapter 15. The first one we looked at last week that said in verses 4 and 5, or 5 and 6, may the God of steadfastness and encouragement grant you to live in harmony with one another in accordance with Christ Jesus, so that together you may with one voice glorify the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. Last week we talked about we're right where we're supposed to be when we're living in unity with our brothers and sisters. And this week, our benediction is again in chapter 15, down in verse 13, and it says this: may the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing, so that you may abound in hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. Abounding in hope. You know, hope is one of those words that are really important for us to get into focus, because so many people hope for so many things. And oftentimes when they use the word hope, it's almost like I wish. And biblical hope is very different from wishing. It's not subjunctive. It's not saying, you know, if the stars align in the right place, then this will happen, I hope. It's not wishful thinking, but hope is something different. You know, Paul wrote in 1 Corinthians 13, he says, these three things abide: faith, hope, and love. Now, those three great things that abide, as you think about them, faith, first of all, compels us to look up and to have confidence in the true and living God. Our faith is focused on an object, and the object of our faith is always God. Love compels us to look around and to encourage those who need our help. The kind of love that God plants in our hearts starts to move us, first of all, towards caring for each other and then caring for those around us, neighbors and those people that we may not know. It's love that causes us to look around and see where we are needed in terms of service. But hope motivates us to look ahead, to look forward with assurance, knowing the promises of God in Christ. Our hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. It's on his finished work. It's based upon what has already been done and what God has promised is going to happen. Hope is not the way we feel. Oh, I just feel hopeless, or I'm filled with hope. It's not some kind of optimism, natural optimism. Some people are just optimistic. Some people are pessimistic. Now, hope, biblical hope, is very different than that. In fact, in the book of Romans earlier on in chapter 4, Paul wrote this about the kind of hope that Abraham had. Now, you'll remember this passage. Hoping against hope, speaking of Abraham, he believed that he would become the father of many nations according to what was said, so numerous shall your descendants be. He did not weaken in faith when he considered his own body, which was already as good as dead, for he was about 100 years old, or when he considered the barrenness of Sarah's womb. No distrust made him waver concerning the promise of God, but he grew strong in his faith as he gave glory to God, being fully convinced that God was able to do what he had promised. In spite of the circumstances, in spite of what he saw as he looked at himself and he looked at Sarah, he still had the hope that God would fulfill his promises. And he did. That's the kind of hope. It's the way that 1 Peter puts it in the first chapter, where he says, blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. By his great mercy, he has given us a new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. The hope that we have of eternal life is based upon the fact that Jesus raised from the dead. If he lives, then I too shall live. That is our hope. The living word of the living Savior gives you that living hope. And so we live with hope. Now, without Christ, there is no hope. Without Christ is without hope and without God. It's the way Paul puts it in Ephesians chapter 2. He says this, remember that you were at that time without Christ, being aliens from the commonwealth of Israel and strangers to the covenants of promise, having no hope and without God in the world. Apart from Christ, there is no hope. Oh, there's lots of wishful thinking. There's lots of optimistic hope that maybe things will, but when you base your hope on what God has said, your hope becomes certain. You know, this morning, as I was down here early this morning, I was just walking around the building to check the doors and things, and there were a couple people sitting on the stairs in front of the front doors of the church, and I said, what are you guys doing? They said, well, we're waiting for the bus. And I said, oh, you're waiting for the bus? I said, are you sure it's coming? And the guy looked at me and he says, every day for the last 10 years, that bus has come at 6:35. Now, his hope was not based upon he hopes the bus comes. It was based upon the fact that every day the bus came and he got on it and went to work in downtown LA. And that's hope that's based on certainty. It comes every day. I have hope that it's going to come today, just like it did yesterday. That's the kind of hope that the Bible talks about. In fact, the writer to the book of Hebrews puts it this way. He talks about hope as an anchor of the soul. Listen to these verses from Hebrews verse chapter 6. So that through two unchangeable things, in which it is impossible that God would prove false, we who have taken refuge might be strongly encouraged to seize the hope set before us. We have this hope, a sure and steadfast anchor of the soul, a hope that enters the inner shrine beyond the curtain. Our hope is secure. The presence of God is available to us at all times. It's not something, maybe God will show up today. He's here with us. It's based upon certainty. Our hope of eternal life is based upon what God himself has said. It's certain. It's an anchor. So nothing can ever change what God has said. And so we're anchored on what he has said. What can ever separate us from God's love? COVID? No, nothing can. And so our hope is based upon the truth of what God's word says. Now, our text this morning says this, may the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing so that you may abound in hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. Four things this benediction says to us are ours that God provides for us. First of all, is that you live in the future tense. Now, we learn from the past. All of us have had experiences in the past where we've learned lessons. Sometimes those experiences were hard. They were challenging. Sometimes they were disappointing. Sometimes they were wonderful. We saw how things worked, and we have added them into our lives to keep them going. We've learned from the past. And we live every single day in the present. It's right now. It's 11:42 California time. Right now, this is where we are in the presence. This is where we live. But as believers, this passage tells us that we are motivated by the future. Our hope is in the promises of God. Just what the writer to Jeremiah said to Israel as they were going to experience 70 years of captivity. As they were going into captivity, he reminded them that God was not finished with them yet, but God had a plan for them. And so wait until the plan of God is finished. Your hope is in that God is not finished with Israel. And so Jeremiah writes, he says, surely I know the plans I have for you, says the Lord, plans for your welfare and not for harm, to give you a future with hope. Well, those are important verses. Because many times the things we experience in the present are hard and they're challenging. But God has a plan to give us a hope for the future. And we need to live in that future tense. In fact, the Apostle Paul in his letters, Romans through 2 Timothy and Titus, uses the form of the word for hope 56 times. I don't think there's any word other than grace that he uses more than the word hope. Hope is one of his major themes. When you think through the Bible, the patriarchs, they certainly put their hope in what God had promised them. The writer to the book of Hebrews reminds us of that in the 11th chapter, talking about Abraham. For he looked forward to the city that has foundations, whose architect and builder is God. By faith, he received power of procreation, even though he was too old. And Sarah herself was barren, because he considered him faithful who had promised. Therefore, from one person, and this one as good as dead, descendants were born, as many as the stars of heaven and as the innumerable grains of sand by the seashore. All of these patriarchs, died in faith without having received the promises, but from a distance they saw and greeted them. That's hope. Our hope is in the promises of God, not in our experience that we are involved in at the present time, but in what God has promised us, whether we ever experience it or not. That's our hope. That's biblical hope. The opposite of that is despair. Without hope, there's nothing but desperation. There's depression. There's discouragement. Things are always going to be this way. They're never going to change. This is the way it's always going to be. And it's so depressing if there's not hope that tomorrow is going to bring a better day. And God has promised that the best is yet to come. And so we approach every day, no matter where we find ourselves, with this hope that God is at work. He's working in all things together and for the good of those who love him. And so we have that hope every single day. See, it's hope that moves us forward. It's the hope that we have that lies ahead that causes us to move in such a way today to accomplish what we hope for tomorrow. It's hope that motivates farmers. In the springtime, they plant seed with the hope that come fall, there's going to be a harvest. I mean, if you didn't have the hope of a harvest, you wouldn't spend the time preparing the soil and planting the seed. It's the hope that moves them forward. It's teachers. You teach somebody, you start in September, you're starting to teach them concepts and ideas, et cetera, that by the end of the year will have grown into new ideas that will prepare them for the next year. If there's not a hope that these kids are going to learn, why would you teach? Of course, there's hope. Investors invest with hope. You put money in an investment with the hope that it's going to grow, that the investment is going to grow. And so that's what motivates investors. Scientists today, we have scientists that are struggling hard every single day to come up with a vaccine for COVID, who are working through finding treatment options for people with COVID today. If they didn't think that they were going to be successful, they'd quit. They wouldn't be working. But laboratories are filled with people because they have the hope of finding the answer. That's why scientists work so hard. You ever noticed that God puts our eyeballs in the front of our head? He intends for us to move forward, not backward, not just seeing out of the side, but forward, to move forward. That's hope. So the first thing we learn here is that we need to learn how to live in the future tense. The second thing that this benediction says to us, that we live in the overflow, not the undertow. It's the word here. It says, may the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing, so that you may abound in hope. In many versions, that word is overflow in hope. I don't know if we've all gone to the beach. We live here in Southern California. We've all gone to the beach and seen the signs from time to time that talk about be careful of the undertow. There's a real strong current that's underneath. It looks calm on the surface, but underneath, the current is moving in a direction. If you're not careful, if you get in the water, it'll pull you under and it'll take you far away from where you started. And some people even drown because of the undertow. So be careful of the undertow. The idea is for us to overflow with hope, not get caught in the undertow. And in life, there's a lot of undertows. And this is one of the reasons why so many of these characters, these stories in the Old Testament are told. Think about Moses and Aaron. Moses is up on Mount Horeb receiving the law from God, the Ten Commandments. There's light all around. I mean, God is, his finger is burning the Ten Commandments. And this is the highest spiritual moment in Moses' life. But at the same time that he's up there, Aaron is down there being persuaded by the people to form a golden cow that they can worship in instead of Jehovah God. I mean, the undertow pulled him right under. Think of David and Bathsheba at the height of David's career as king, at the point where he is the strongest in his position as king. It's the time when his armies go out for battle and he stays behind. He's tired of going out there, and he says, you guys go ahead, I trust you. And it's then that he looks out his window and he sees Bathsheba, and all that sin with Bathsheba takes place. He has an affair with Bathsheba. It ends up murdering her husband, Uriah. And the undertow, at the point of great success, the undertow pulls him under. Think of the story of Peter on the water. In the middle of the night, the disciples are in the boat going to the other side of the shore in the Sea of Galilee. And in the middle of the night, Jesus comes walking on the water and they're frightened. They think it's a ghost. And Jesus says, it's me. Don't be afraid. And if it's you, have me come and walk on the water. And Jesus says, come on. And Peter starts walking on the water until he realizes that people can't walk on the water. And he sees the wind and hears the wind and he feels the waves and he starts to sink, the undertow. He stopped having his hope in Jesus. You know, the idea of this passage says to us that we are not to see God's blessing as something that we are to contain in ourselves. And we say, isn't God good to me? And so we become a reservoir where we're just sucking up all of God's goodness and enjoying it ourselves. But the picture here is that we are to be channels of God's blessing. God blesses us so that we can bless others. It's the story to Abraham. He says, I'm going to make of you a great nation so that you can all be a blessing to all of the nations everywhere. We're channels of God's blessing, not reservoirs. And what we overflow with in this passage tells us, we overflow with joy and peace. I mean, joy and peace. Can you imagine in today's world, if people saw other people who were filled with joy and who were at peace, given the circumstances we find ourselves in? You know, too many people are climbing the walls. Too many people are agitated and upset, and they're frustrated, and they act out. He says, I want you to overflow with joy, first of all. The joy of my presence, the joy of the Lord is my strength, Paul said, two different times. Rejoice in the Lord. Find your joy in the Lord. Overflowing with joy and overflowing with peace. It's the song that Christy just sang. It's well with me. You know, stuff is out of control all around us, but with me, it's well. And I'm not going to find myself complaining. I'm not going to find myself resentful. I'm going to go through every single day in the presence of the Lord, filled, overflowing with joy and peace. What a difference it would make in other people's lives if they saw joy and peace in ours. And that's what we're supposed to be. We're supposed to be channels of God's joy and peace towards others. So claim your joy and peace by faith. This passage says this is what God wants to produce in your life. Claim it and live it out by faith. The third idea that we see in this passage is that idea to the degree. He says living by faith in believing. I like this. He says, may the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing, in faith. In faith, this comes to us as we believe, as you trust in him, literally, as you trust in him, believing in spite of what you are seeing all around you. See, that's what believing in him does. We believe in who God is. We believe in what God has said in spite of what we're seeing all around us. I mean, think again, Abraham and Isaac. God said to Abraham, I want you to take your son up onto the mountain. I want you to offer him as a sacrifice. Abraham all the time thinking, I want you to take Isaac with you to make sacrifice. And Abraham all the time thinking that God's going to provide. And he gets up there and he realizes as he looks around, there's the wood, there's the stones, and the only thing here to sacrifice is his son. And he believed God, and you remember, he put him on the altar, and he had the knife up in the air, ready to put it down, until God said, Abraham, stop, look over there, and there was a ram. But he believed God in spite of what he was saying. He was going to do what God told him to do. Moses in the Red Sea. I mean, we've seen this picture so many times. Moses is at the head of 3 million Israelites who are escaping from Egypt. And they're going through the wilderness and they come to the Sea of Galilee, or the Red Sea. And there it is right in front of them. And behind them are all of Pharaoh's armies, the chariots, the soldiers, the arrows, the spears, all of those kinds of things. And they're gaining on them. And in front of them is the Red Sea. We're doomed. And God says, Abraham, believe. He says, speak to the sea. Tell the sea to open. And he says those words and the sea opens. And they walk through. And by the time they're done and the Pharaoh's army comes behind them, the waters come over them, and they have a great victory. I mean, he saw we're doomed, but he believed in God, and the miraculous happened. The sea opened up. It's the story of David and Goliath. Here's this little kid, David, you know, about 5'5", ruddy kid, it says. So he's probably hasn't gotten all the way through puberty. And here's this 9-foot Goliath, a giant, a fighting man, a sword taller than David is, armor all over him, a mighty man of valor. And here's this little shepherd boy. And David says, you know, I've slain a lion, I've slain a bear, and God's calling me to slay this 9-foot uncircumcised son of a Philistine. He says, he had no doubt about it. He picked up a rock, threw it, and boom, a little kid killed a 9-foot mighty warrior because he believed God. Think of the story. We just went through it a couple years ago of Esther and Haman, you know, Queen Esther. And then Haman is this official, and he's going to destroy all of the Jews. And he's come up with a plan, and the king has signed off on it. And it comes to the place where, Esther, you're the one who can deliver your people. Who, me? And it said to her, you are here for maybe for just a time such as this. And she believed God, and she went into the king, and Haman ended up being destroyed, and her people were saved. I mean, because she believed God, Jesus and the cross. You know, it's easy to believe in a resurrection until you're hanging on the cross. That's what it's really hard. But he believed God and he died. He realized he's dying for the sins of the world. And on the third day, he was raised again from the dead, believing in spite of what you're seeing. See, that's faith. Now, faith grows as you are in the word. What causes our faith to abound? What causes our faith to grow? It's the word of God, because our hope is in what God's word has said. It's what the writer to Romans, what Paul said again. So faith comes from what is heard, and what is heard comes through the word of Christ. Faith grows through the word of Christ, through what Christ has said, our faith grows. So we have to live by the faith in what Christ has said, not in what we're seeing, not in what we're experiencing around us, but in what God has promised. That's where hope is built, on what God has said. And this is all produced in us by the Holy Spirit. It's not like we can crank this up. It's not like we can have faith. It's not like we have hope. And it's not a motivational thing. This is something that the Holy Spirit does in us. Hope is produced by the Holy Spirit. And it's produced through the difficulties of life. As the writer, again, Paul said in Romans chapter 5, he says, therefore, since we are justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, to whom we've obtained access to this grace in which we stand, and we boast in the hope of sharing the glory of God. Our hope is in sharing the presence of God forevermore. But how do you get that? And not only that, he says, but we also boast in our sufferings, knowing that suffering produces endurance, and endurance produces character, and character produces hope. So you don't crank up hope. Hope is produced by the presence of God in our lives during the difficult times. Look at the words of what he says here. We boast in our sufferings. Now, the word suffering is the word thlipsis. It's the word that means squeezing. It's the word that means pressure. Things that happen in our lives that squeeze us, that put pressure on us, that cause us the discomfort. Now, we certainly find ourselves in one of those moments right now, don't we? I mean, there's a lot of discomfort that's happening. The postponement of going back to school physically and having to do school online, the, you know, all of the different issues, still working at home and all of this, wearing a mask and on and on and on and on and on. There's a lot of discomfort. A lot of things that are squeezing us, that are making us feel uncomfortable. That's suffering. That's thalipsis. That's the squeezing that it's talking about. He says this, now knowing that when we're squeezed, when our confidence is in the fact that God is at work in this situation that's squeezing us, he says that squeezing produces endurance. We're able to put up with it because we know that somehow God's going to work through this. The squeezing's not the end. It's just part of the process. And so we endure. We endure these moments. Man, I'm 70 years old. I've seen a ton of these moments in my life. So some of you guys who are listening to this, this might be the first major issue that you've gone through. Trust me, it won't be the last. And so we endure them. We don't lose patience and get upset and get mad. You know, however long this is going to take is how long it's going to take. It's not a question of somebody's making it happen longer. It's just, it is what it is. And there is going to be another day after this day. There's going to be another issue. Things are going to be back to probably not normal, but there's going to be a new normal that's going to come up. That's certainly my hope, that we're not going to be meeting like this forever. That God isn't finished. And so we endure what we have to endure. And endurance produces character. You know what? We're growing through this time. There's character that's being developed in us. We're learning patience. There's all kinds of things that we're learning. We're learning how to be more creative than we've ever been before. I mean, you know, some of you are doing cooking. You've never done cooking before. And all of a sudden, you know, you're feeding your family and they're doing okay. You know, you're not killing them. That's good. I mean, it produces character. It's the squeezing of life as we endure through it that produces character in us, and character produces hope, because it's the evidence that God is not finished with us, that there's more ahead that God still has not accomplished yet in our lives. And so we look forward. That's what hope is. We're looking forward. You know, I hope that I have not grown as much as I'm going to grow in my life. There's more growth to do. And I found that I grow far more through squeezing than I do through good times. I get satisfied when things are going good, but when things are hard, now you have to dig deep to hang on, to endure. And so character produces hope. And that process is the Holy Spirit working in our lives. The Holy Spirit is the evidence now of the promises still to come. If God is doing this stuff in our lives now in producing maturity, in producing character, there's still more to come. That's the evidence. I like the way Scripture gives us the picture of the Holy Spirit as just a down payment. It's just 10%. It's just a little bit of what we're going to receive in heaven, of what we're going to receive at the end of this physical life when we enter into the presence of God where there's pleasure forevermore. You know, my hope is that it's going to be 90% better. Spirituality is going to be 90% better in the presence of God than it is right now, and it's pretty darn good right now. That's the whole idea. And that creates hope. Even through the challenges of life, it creates hope. Now, this benediction, it pretty much said what it's supposed to say. But I just have a couple thoughts. First, God produces in us what he knows we need. Last week, it says he produces unity, a desire to live in harmony. He knows we can't pull that off ourselves. So he wants to produce it. He wants to produce unity in us. And he knows that we can't produce hope by ourselves. Most people tend to be more discouraged than they are encouraged. It's hard to crank up hope in the midst of an ongoing pandemic. In the midst of things continuing on and on, getting worse, getting better, getting worse, getting better. It's hard to be hopeful, to crank that up ourselves. And so God produces it in us. As people, don't just think about us as Americans. Think about God's people all over the world. I mean, we have far more reason for hope than many people do in their circumstances and situations. But God produces hope in all his people. He's producing hope because we need hope, because life is filled with challenges. Life, to live as a Christian in this world is not my home. We're not normal here. Christians are not normal here. And so there's going to be squeezing. There's going to be difficulties living the Christian life. And so as long as we're alive, there's going to be difficulties. And so we're going to need to be hopeful. We're going to need to find our hope, not in what we're experiencing, but in what God has promised, what God says he's doing in us. Now, here's to me, this is the application. Whenever we find ourselves looking back with regret or looking around with fear, we've stopped living in the future tense. Let me say that again. Whenever we find ourselves looking back with regret, thinking about the past, you know, many of us who are in recovery, this is one of the big problems in recovery, is we keep focused on where we were and all the horrible things that were done to us, all the horrible things we did, etc. You've got to get at forgiveness always moves us forward. He takes our sins and he buries them in the deepest sea. We used to sing this song when I was a kid, gone, 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 gone. Yes, my sins are gone. They're gone. Don't live there. Don't look back with regret. And don't look around with fear. Man, there is always stuff in our lives that can produce fear, but fear immobilizes us. God's love casts out fear, doubt, and insecurity. And so free yourself from that fear. I mean, we sang that in the first two songs that we sang today. It was all about letting go of your fear. There is no fear in the presence of Christ. He's in charge, and we trust in him. Our hope is in him. And whenever we look back with regret or look around with fear, we've stopped living in the future tense. See, we need, how many times in Scripture are God's people told to wait? Wait, wait, wait. I think it's over 130 some, if I remember right. Wait is one of the most, we wait. And the word wait and the word hope are the same word. We're waiting for what God has promised. And so, in other words, if you're waiting for it, it hasn't yet come. So what we've got coming is all the difficulties of life that we're experiencing. Wait, God's not finished. There's more yet to come. And that's where our hope is put, in the future tense. True hope. And I like the way these words came together here. True hope enables us to look at earth from heaven's point of view. In other words, God's got a plan. Step one, step two, step three, step four. We might be in step one. And God looks down and he says, they're in step one. There's a lot more yet to come. We are living in step one. What do we see? Step one. Now, hope enables us to look at step one from heaven's point of view and say, there's more to come. There's more to come. This isn't all there is. There's more to come. It enables us to look at earth from heaven's point of view and to see the present in light of the future. And this keeps us going no matter how difficult the circumstances may be. That's what keeps us going, is the hope that God's got his hands in all of this. That's why that verse in Romans is so important, that God is working together for the good of those who love him, who are called according to his purposes. When you've surrendered your life to Christ and you're living right there, God's hands are at work in your life. He's got a plan. He's got a purpose being worked out. And you're at this point and God's purpose is over here. And so wait, wait. Don't make conclusions at point A. Make conclusions at the end. And what we do as we come to worship is we worship with the faith that says God is good. He was good then. He's good now. And God, his plan for my life is always going to be good. So I'm going to trust in him. That's what worship is all about. See, we are created. Here's the last thought here. We are created in Christ to overflow with peace, with joy, peace, and hope as we trust in him. Now, it seems to me that if that's the overflow of our lives, then this is our testimony to the world as we find ourselves in challenging times. Who should be leading our country in terms of hope? It should be the church. The church should be the ones leading us out of this morass that we find ourselves in with a sense of hope. that this isn't all there is. This is just a piece of what there is. God has so much more for us. And so we're hoping in his finished work, in his plan, in his purpose. I mean, because there's always going to be something that we can let overwhelm us if we're going to be fearful. I mean, there's lots of stuff all over the place. And so what we do is we trust that God's got this thing, and we overflow with joy and with peace, even during these challenging times. That's our testimony. That's what we have to share. I don't have any other answers about COVID, about any of that other stuff. I don't have any solutions. I don't have any of that stuff. But what I do have is I have the joy that God is in charge of all of this, and I trust him completely. And I have peace. It's okay with me. I'm okay right in the middle of it. If I got to wear a mask, I'm okay with that. If I don't have to wear a mask, I'm okay with that. If I have to sit 6 feet away from somebody, I'm okay from that. If I have to stay home, I'm okay with that. In fact, I prefer staying home, you know? However, see, peace and joy, rather than resentment and complaining and all those other kinds of things that we spend so much doing. I love the way that Charles Williams, in his translation, puts this benediction. And so as we close, I want to read it from his translation. Listen to these words. May the hope-inspiring God so fill you with perfect joy and peace through your continuing faith that you may bubble over with hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. Let's not settle for less. Let's pray together. Lord Jesus, thank you for giving us hope. Thank you for giving us hope that's based on the certainty that the things you have promised us are absolutely true. May we be like Abraham and not be experiencing them right now, but looking ahead and seeing out in the future the finished purpose of you, of yours in our lives and in our world. Lord, give us hope that moves us beyond the present circumstances into a sense of overflowing joy and peace. I pray this morning in Jesus' name. Amen. Jesus Christ, my living. Thank you for being a part of our service this morning. We're so grateful for your faithful attendance and your giving. This week, there's all kinds of Bible studies and small group meetings that happen on Zoom. Check out our webpage for the things that are taking place. There's a devotional that happens every single morning that you can check in. We just thank you for your participation with us in the ministry. Stay focused on the promises that God has made for you and have hope in them. Have a good week.